I set out to determine just how bad burner inserters are for energy efficiency compared to everything else. And we'll get to that. But in some cursory testing, I discovered that the power draw behavior of inserters is weird. Like, real weird. The energy economy of inserters actually works very differently from what I'd initially thought. I'd done the math assuming that they consumed their maximum power as long as they were turning, but that's not quite right. Energy consumption peaks when picking up or placing an object, and while swinging, it consumes a fraction. Somewhere around 30% by my testing. For instance, while a fast inserter's maximum power draw is 59.3 kilowatts, if I set it up to work continuously, we can see that its operating consumption jumps between 17 kilowatts while swinging, and 59 kilowatts for a single frame while picking up or placing an item. So overall, its power consumption is only 20.8 kilowatts. Slower inserters actually draw the maximum power for more frames while making contact, so they use a bit more power per cycle. But this is evened out by their dramatically lower maximum draw. What else could I do but set up some test circuits? I'll supply every type of inserter with exactly 20 megajoules of power. That's 4 fully charged accumulators, and for the burner inserter, 5 pieces of coal. I can measure the output of each arm just by counting the products deposited, and then use a clock to stopwatch how long it took them all to run dry. Except for the burner inserter, which I had to set up using 2 resetting clocks, one of which runs continuously and the other resets every time the inserter picks up an item, and only when that clock does not exceed a certain value is the value of the other clock sent through the Nixie tube for display. But when that value is overflowed, then output for a single frame to a memory cell which holds the value of that other clock for that single frame, then sends it to the Nixie tube in order to pause the display at the final value. All because you can't read the current fuel in a burner inserter. It's not 100% accurate, but it's in the ballpark, and putting it together made my head spin. Frankly, the fact that it works at all confuses me. While the results cook, here's an important explanation. Joules are an amount of energy, and watts are an amount of energy used over time. A watt is 1 joule used over 1 second. A watt hour is an amount of energy equal to 3600 joules, because that's how many joules it takes to consume 1 watt for 1 hour. But we don't do that here. Don't shake the hands of people who use watt hours. Do not look them in the eyes. Factorio works in joules and watts, but not watt hours. Generally, you will need to know the joules a system consumes in order to know how much coal, solid fuel, or nuclear fuel cells are needed to produce the amount of watts that a system consumes. A combinator needs 1 kilowatt to run and has no variance in consumption, which means it consumes 60 kilojoules per minute, meaning that it will consume a standard lump of coal in power every 66 minutes. So now we have our test data. By dividing 20,000 by the top number, we can determine how many kilojoules each arm uses per item moved. By dividing 20,000 by the bottom number, we can determine the average kilowatt draw. Simply put, normal, long-armed, fast, and stack inserters operate at about 2 kilojoules per item moved. Fast inserters taking the most of all of them. Stack inserters don't fare very well in container-to-container tests like this for obvious reasons. They are optimized for belt stacking and have a commensurately high power draw. I did test them in a container-to-belt scenario and found their kilowatt per item to be a little under 3. Much higher than anything else except a burner inserter, but that's the price you pay. As for power used per second, the results are on screen now. Actual consumption is nowhere near the listed maximum consumption for any scenario, but the burner inserter consumes on average a staggering 51 kilowatts. Which is 15% less than a stack inserter, while only moving about 12% of the cargo. On average, I would budget that any inserter will be using about 40% of its listed max consumption when in operation. Burner inserters use 16 kilojoules per item moved, 8 times more energy than anything else. Burner inserters don't draw power when not in use, unlike all the others, but their colossal power draw when in use makes it difficult to recommend them. A standard inserter uses 1.7 kilojoules to move 4 items and then consumes 400 watts, or 0.4 kilojoules per second, when idle. This means that in order for the burner inserter to use less power than the standard inserter per operation, it will need to operate less than once every 36 seconds. Since the primary use of burner inserters by most people is to create a brownout-proof fuel insertion method for a steam boiler, keep in mind the highest speed of operation needed to keep one fed. Boilers consume a maximum of 1.8 megawatts. Simply put, 1 unit of coal every 2.22 repeating seconds. With a max inserter stack size of 4, a burner inserter will need to input a fresh stack at least every 8.88 seconds. Or in other words, if your boiler is performing at 1/4 capacity, your burner inserters are consuming more power than a standard inserter. This is even worse at lower stack sizes, when the burner inserter will spend even less time idle. Sure enough, in testing, an inserter feeding a boiler under maximum load draws only 1.1 kilowatts on average. Barely more than a combinator. A single solar panel that is turned on 1/4 of the time with an accumulator can keep these 10 boilers stocked just fine. You can also put a separate boiler with a turbine ahead of all the others and have its power output to these inserters exclusively. At a measly 15 kilowatts of draw, 10 inserters will take over 4 minutes to chew through a single piece of coal. Using a priority input splitter to keep a single stack of coal in a chest to feed this backup generator, you will have almost 4 hours of brownout protection. It might cost a few more materials in the early game, but it will take no time at all for your decrease in consumption of coal to pay for itself. But this is, of course, not the full story. Container-to-container insertion is a very sterile environment with no randomness. When belts get involved, everything really goes out the window. Power consumption is peaked when picking up items, 1/3 in transit, minimum when dropping on a belt. And I have no idea what the hell is going on with these little hysteresis patterns. But wait, it gets worse. Is the belt bent? That will measurably change the power draw over time. Is the item on the near or far side of the belt? Believe it or not, it seems like the items being on the far lane consumes less power. Why? I really have no clue. It's a documented effect that the items moved per second varies depending on different belt types and belt bends, but belt lanes? That's just beyond me. Take the exact same setup of inserters and belts and rotate it 90, 180, and 270 degrees, and you might get different power draws. In this test, the power draw of the right and bottom configurations are 79.1 kilowatts. The top is 71.3, and the left is 71.5. Just to spite me, copy and paste the build, suddenly the power is uniform. Copy and paste it again, 71.5 on only one of them. Every time I retake these results, it's different somehow. It almost seems like it behaves better when I turn on OBS to record it. At this point, I'm willing to call inserter power draw an eldritch force. If the belt is fast but not fully saturated, then the power demand becomes very high as the inserter spends more of its time reaching for items. Between all the different types of arms and all the different types of belt configurations and saturations, there are way too many variables for me to test, and most of the results I found made me start to feel crazy. But the takeaway I can give you is that the most I could ever get an inserter to pull is about half of its listed consumption, with peaks and valleys. If you like to test scenarios for yourself, I'll provide an annotated blueprint in the description. I've also gone back and added appropriate blueprints to my previous videos where possible, due to popular demand. Read the descriptions of the blueprints themselves and of each combinator therein for usage instructions. Also, these blueprints might require a few mods, mods which I recommend anyways, such as editor extensions, push button, and text plate. I have a very old, sort of awful video on how to use push button, but it's still accurate and I made it because I couldn't find any videos explaining it. The only thing I left out is that you have to bind the key for push button manually. I normally hate self-promotion, but whatever. Now obviously the power draw of inserters is hilariously small compared to actual machines. But you will be using literally thousands of these things, so intelligent usage can really add up over time. And it's worth mentioning that an inserter that is disabled by circuit conditions still consumes its minimum power draw. If you want to cut power to an inserter entirely under specific conditions, you'll need to use a power switch. I actually love power switches, although most players tend to agree that they are unnecessary. And as long as you have a good nuclear reactor setup, they aren't wrong. The best use case for this would be cutting power to train loading stations when all the chests are full and there's no train to load. This is accomplished with a simple AND gate. However, the power draw of the combinator itself eats into a noticeable amount of your energy savings. Shutting off the power to bulk inserters in a 4-wagon train stop will save 48 kilowatts. But you will probably spend 1 kilowatt continuously on the combinator to make that happen. Or you can just use multiple power switches. Power switches don't have a power draw. Set one to only provide power to the loaders if the chests aren't full, and the other to only turn on when a train enters the station. Chests don't need power to output a circuit condition, and neither do train stations. If you're using an AND gate to make sure that all four loading stations have sufficient stock before calling a train, however, the combinators should not be placed alongside the chests, as when a combinator stops receiving power, it stops updating its circuit signal, and it kills the entire process. Should you worry about saving 48 kilowatts per station? Probably not. Most engineers start slapping down lamps in their bases once they get to somewhere around chemical science. I usually place at least 6 per loading station myself. Their power draw is 5 kilowatts each, adjusted to 2.5 kilowatts continuous due to the day-night cycle. So I'm spending 15 kilowatts just to make sure this place looks pretty when I'm not even here. The power draw of lamps is a little funky, by the way. 5 kilowatts for an effective radius of just 10 meters. The Moonlight Towers in Austin, Texas use 6 400-watt bulbs equaling 2.4 kilowatts to light an area the radius of 460 meters. Or I should say used. They switched to LEDs and now only use 480 watts total. Street lamps cover about the same radius as the in-game lamps and use only 100 watts. Sports stadium lights usually come in 1.5 kilowatt bulbs, and while their usage can eventually be measured in megawatts, it's also covering an area the size of a football field in functionally daylight. I'm sorry, how many megawatts?